Welcome back, everybody. This is show number 595. My name is Larry here at Xbox Live's Major Nelson. We're in the studio. We took a little bit of time off. Well, we took a week off. Hi, Laura.
Hello.
Laura Massey there. Hello, Laura. Sitting next to you is Jeff Rubenstein. Hello, Jeff.
Hi, reporting in from the kids' table.
And joining us, he puts the brrr in Brexit. And every time he opens his mouth, he gets a plus 15 bonus on charisma, Mr. Graham Boyd.
Wow. You've been working on that.
I have. I wrote that this morning in the shower.
Oh, topical.
You wrote it in the shower.
Well, yeah, sometimes when you do your best writing.
So I thought you meant like actually physically wrote it.
No. I actually spend time on this show. It's nice to see you.
Oh, it's a pleasure to be back again.
Yeah, you were back. I was checking. You were actually over here looking. Looks like you were here February 2nd.
Oh. God, thank you for tracking my schedule so closely.
I'm tracking.
Welcome to America.
Exactly. How long will we be staying, Mr. Boyd?
I leave today.
Well, again, you're doing that whole British Airways at 5 or 6 o'clock.
This always feels like it's the kind of the highest point of the week for me because I get to see you guys.
Right.
And then I'm basically like, I'm straight out the door. I'm like, well, it's not going to get any better than that.
And then you're
so
home.
Well just get on the
and
plus 20 charisma.
Yeah. And you're back tomorrow. You land tomorrow afternoon.
Yeah.
At home.
So it's like Friday lunchtime.
Friday
UK
lunchtime.
Time,
right.
Which will be the
How things going over there?
Yeah. Good.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's been an interesting week. You mentioned the B word.
Yeah.
Up front.
Article 50. So is that it?
But number one in our hearts. In
yeah.
And then, as you may have heard, Scotland are now. Or at least the Scottish government is agitating for another independence referendum. So, you know, it's lots of exciting politics everywhere in the world.
We don't really go get too deep on politics around here because you'll instantly piss off 50% of your audience.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, but with Scottish, it's okay because you're the only Scot that listens.
No,
I'm sure. I think we actually do have quite a bit of audience.
A lot of listeners in Scotland.
Well, we have even more now that you're on.
Oh, okay. Well,
I want the whole
you.
Aberdeen football team listening in.
Yeah, I'll do my bit about that. I actually, Aberdeen FC started selling, you know, like decals for Xbox Ones and Xbox One controllers.
Oh, really?
2 weeks ago or something. So I bought a pack.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
did you bring any with you?
I didn't bring them with me, no.
Jeff would love some.
Yeah. Do you leave stickers on your... Do you leave that sticker on your Xboxes?
No, I'm team no sticker.
Excellent.
Yeah, same. Laura?
It's a relief.
Yeah, no stickers.
Yeah.
No stickers. Yeah. Is that consensus in the room then?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, okay.
We do. There's no reason to have the sticker on there.
No, I agree.
I know it's been approved by the HDMI authority. You don't need to put a sticker on to tell me. It's got a port in the back. I can figure the rest out.
Yeah. So I don't usually condone of stickers on Xbox Ones, but...
But that's a different sticker.
These are like branded.
Yeah, this is...
Aberdeen FC. Anyway, so I tweeted...
It's more of a skin, right?
Yeah, it's
yeah,
a skin.
It's a different term.
I tweeted a picture of my... of the controller that I put the controller skin onto, and... Aberdeen FC like picked it up and retweeted it and stuff, which was
really?
Quite cool.
Wow.
And
awesome.
Then it got into the Scottish Sun, which is like, you know, a big newspaper in Scotland on Sunday. There was, on the video games pages, there was a little box.
Wait a minute.
Out
There's a video game page?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, that's cool.
Did they attribute you?
Yeah, the guy that does it is great. He's a massive Forza fan and he really likes it.
So you know this gentleman?
Through Twitter.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But you know, he featured my actual, my controller.
Did your family see it?
No.
No.
We don't have any family in Scotland anymore. We're all down south now.
Oh, okay.
All southerners. Anyway, that was a bit of a tangent, wasn't it?
It was cool you're in the paper.
Yeah.
You tweet.
Still get excited about that, though. That's the thing about the digital world, right? It's when you actually make the pages of a printed paper.
That means,
oh my God,
this is amazing. That means somebody put it in, you know, into, they did the digital version of typesetting.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody approved it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It went into a printing press. Yeah. Somebody pulled that paper off. They put it into a newspaper. They bound it up. Somebody bought it. Yeah. I mean, you're right. It's a whole life cycle.
Yes.
So well done. Maybe. Send that photo over if you have it.
Did you
tweet the done is tweeted a photo of your tweet from the paper. That would have been meta.
Oh, you're right.
Right.
Okay, I'll have to try and get a back issue.
Right.
Tweet a printed version of a tweet.
Right.
Now you need to get back into the paper and then do it. No one wants to. You don't.
Well, a picture of me in the paper holding a picture of the paper.
Yes.
This has gone too far.
This has gone. Yeah, we're aware of news. Anyway, we used to talk about what we're playing. Have you had a chance to play anything? I know you. Again, when you travel, you don't really have a chance to play.
Yeah, been quite bad. Last week was really busy as well. So unfortunately, the only thing I've really been able to play was while I've been traveling is Zelda on my Switch.
Sure.
Mm. So, which was I was actually really looking forward to it because I knew I'd be on the plane for 10 hours, and it's really the first time I've actually had. Really a chance I've had to play Zelda at all, but then also knowing I was going to be able to do it on the move like that was quite exciting. And yeah, it was
how far
was,
are you, because don't no spoilers.
I'm maybe 5 or 6 hours in now, so I'm past all the initial shrines.
Yeah.
The world's just opened up to me.
Yeah.
Which, like, I knew it was coming and I'd heard everyone talking about how amazing an open world game it is. Mm-hmm. But when it actually happened, I was like, oh my God, this is,
well,
this,
I don't know if
this feels huge.
I don't know if you listened to the last show, but the last show we did a couple weeks ago was when we were after PAX and Jeff was sitting next to me on our way over to,
right, yeah,
to PAX, mm-hmm, and I was playing it. I'm probably about 60 hours in now.
Right. Oh my,
wow,
gosh.
Yeah, I'm playing the heck out of this game. Well, I just, you know, it's fun and, you know, playing that and so we'll get to what I'm playing later, but go ahead.
Yeah, it's pretty special. I did get started on Mass Effect Andromeda as well.
Yes.
But again, like maybe an hour, 2 hours in.
But then you had to bolt.
Yeah, exactly.
You've been on the road for quite some time, like all week, right?
Well, just since Sunday, so not too long.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a little bit longer than normal, but it's fine. But yeah, I'm really intrigued by Mass Effect Andromeda. I love the sort of setup and the setting and the, you know, this idea of colonization and stuff. So I really want to get more into that when I get home.
I'm about 10 hours in, and also this is a game that feels much bigger than the previous Mass Effects have. Like just even in some of the initial battle sequences, it was like, oh, I guess I can go kind of in any direction here. Yeah. I guess I'll go over here. So I think in terms of like scope and stuff, they've done a lot more. And I like the combat feel. It feels pretty good.
Yeah,
the fact that just really adding fluid. a jetpack
yeah,
and like a dash just adds so much. Is this fun?
Did you do the multiplayer? Jeff and I did the multiplayer.
No, I haven't tried it.
Oh yeah, that's fun. We should try that.
Yeah. Send me an invite.
Well, it's the time zone thing.
Schedules.
It's the time zone thing.
Yeah. How do you feel about staying up till 6 in the morning?
Yeah, not so good. Get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, so, you know.
There you go.
You can work out. We're out of bed.
Get a little espresso and grab your controller and join us.
Yeah, just...
flat white for you.
Yeah, that sounds nice.
Yeah.
All right, so we'll do that.
What else are you playing? That's it.
I'm kind of striking out after that, to be honest. Yeah, I've been light on games recently, which is a shame, but... Hopefully things will calm down a little bit once I'm back home. I've had lots of planning meetings and lots going on. But
there is a lot going on, isn't there?
Get back into things when I get home.
We have E3 coming up, so you must be lots of planning.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
It's really exciting, but it's that interesting time of year where there's lots of things forming.
Yeah.
So it takes up a lot of headspace, right? You're kind of keeping track of all these...
Right.
These thoughts and ideas and plans.
Well, that's why I'm writing your intro in the shower in the morning. It's the only fair time I have.
Okay. You have a whiteboard in there, Larry?
Maybe.
Do you take your scuba?
No, I actually, it's funny. My wife actually found something that writes, I guess children have, and they write on like the side of bathtubs and things.
Oh, yeah, you can get like
crayons. We have a shower stall and I write things on the side of the glass.
Are you serious?
I'm thinking, yeah.
You really write in the shower?
You want a photo
of
it?
You get a good...
Yeah.
The shower.
What kind of things do you write in there?
Well, I just like, hey, I've got like the personal side and the work side. Hey, this is a great idea. Let's do this.
Oh, nice.
This is a great idea. Oh, I got to make sure I do this. It's just things I tend to forget. You know, it's just, sometimes you have these great thoughts like, oh, that would be really cool.
Yeah.
You know, things like that. So.
I like that.
That's very
always ready to write it down, eh?
Well, you know, I used to do this when I was in college. Or university, for those of you on the other side of the table, I would always, I had a book, much like the book you have there, Graham, mm-hmm, and I had labeled it, this is a true story, when I was a freshman, I labeled it Larry's Life. And in it, I kept track of every single semester, every class I had, all the professors I had, the things I learned, and so you can go back and I look at it, and not only that, but then I would say, okay, so I know this is second year fresh, this is what I need to do for next year, and so I had all my goals and everything in this book.
Wow.
That is incredibly organized.
Yeah, I don't know what happened to me.
And now it's in your shower.
Yeah, now it's in my shower.
I think you should pull out excerpts from time to time.
Would you like to
see? Yeah,
I've got it somewhere.
1978,
AC/DC
rules.
That's a podcast on its own.
Stop it.
You could have a serialized podcast of Larry.
Well, if you go look at the, I hate doing this again, but if you go look at the PAX panel, the PAX keynote I did, I brought a lot of that into this. Like one of the, I'm sorry, I'm boring you all with this.
Oh, yeah.
One of the things that I taught or that I spoke about that I came up with was when I was a freshman, I said, you know what? I don't know anybody here when I was at Syracuse University. I don't know anybody. I'm here by myself. I got to figure this out. I am going to meet a new person every single day. And so through my freshman year, whether I was standing in line at the coffee stand, whether I was at the cafeteria, whether I was in books, whatever. Hi, my name's Larry. How are you? I'm a freshman. What are you? You know, now it would be probably kind of creepy.
Yeah,
but
did the police get involved at any point?
Not to my knowledge. but let's not talk
about
those.
That's a different story. Right?
Then there are some restraining orders, but that's unrelated to this activity. Anyway, so that was my tip. Is always, I've got a lot of those.
The 7 Habits of Highly Effective Showers.
Yes, exactly. I don't think I can top that.
I will never think of you in the shower in the same way again.
Well, you, see now you've got your little book there. I see you're taking some notes. Take note in shower. What do you do to take your notes, Laura? What do you do to remind you? Just write some. You text yourself.
I email myself.
Okay, you're one of those.
I do that. Reminders, yeah. And then I triage my email by if it's unread, I have to respond to it or read it.
But you're responding to yourself.
So I email myself and it stays as unread until I've actioned it.
Oh, I see. So you don't
usually. I remind myself, you know, email this person or, you know, do this, do that.
Right.
And then I keep it unread.
Right.
Until I do it.
Okay.
That's kind of my two. That's
fine. I mean, there's,
it was everywhere with me.
I'm not judging your workflow. It used to, you know, it's back in my day, it was more analog before email.
I do have a to-do list at work.
Okay.
I'm still very much an analog person that way, where I have this huge pad next to my desk that has everything I need to do. Mm-hmm. Written down, and mm-hmm. I absolutely love the feeling of crossing it off.
Oh yeah, that's delightful.
Done. I just do it just for that feeling. And then,
well, that's the one thing you don't get in the digital era. You don't get that when you check the box in OneNote or whatever to do list. It's like you just check the list.
You know which one my favorite is when you've forgotten to write something on your to do list, but you do it. So then you're like, you get to write it on your to do list and immediately score it out. That's the best.
Oh,
that's
productivity.
That's cheap.
No, it's good.
Yeah, it's good.
You're rewarding yourself.
Yeah, okay.
It's a good feeling.
Whatever, Laura. What are you playing?
So I'm a similar situation where it's been a very, very busy couple of weeks at work. So many things, so many exciting things coming up that we can't talk about just yet.
Yes.
Planning and doing those things. And then personal stuff at home has gotten a bit busy too.
All right.
So the few things I've been able to play are here and there, spotty play this week. I haven't had a chance to play Mass Effect 3 yet.
Okay. So is there a problem? What's the problem? You just have a time issue.
I know.
Time management.
I know that I'm going to have to set aside a good amount of time to really get into this game and play it because I just love the Mass Effect series. But I've been playing VR games here and there. Mm-hmm. Still playing Robo Recall, which is super
so
fun.
Good.
So fun. Mm-hmm. And dipping into WoW here and there.
What?
I know. I told you I was still playing WoW.
Yeah, I know.
WoW.
We talked about
still
that.
Still here and there.
Okay.
Yeah, every 30 minutes or so.
Laura partying like it's 2007.
Yeah. It's still a new game. They still update it all the
they
time.
They do.
That was
they
a
do.
Good year, though.
That was. They did a lot. They do. They still do. And we have a lot of friends that work there.
Yes,
at Blizzard, so. Mm-hmm. And there's another Blizzard game that we're playing called Overwatch. You might want to try that.
I have tried that. It's really good.
You haven't tried it with us, so you haven't tried it.
I'm really intimidated by you guys now. I watch your tweets, and you guys talk about how awesome you are.
Oh, there's a lot of that.
No.
Larry's daily, like, play of the game tweet.
I actually have a bunch I haven't even tweeted.
What level are you now?
129, I think. 129.
See, intimidation.
No, but...
50.
Look, so the reality is, I think I've said this on the previous shows, is I tend to play Mercy, the healer, which is your class. So I will say this, if you come join us, I will let you play the healing class.
That is super kind, considering you're 129 in Mercy.
But it's not, no, it's 129 all over. That's not just that character.
It's not like you rank, get extra moves or anything.
Right, yeah. She's, anyway, so go ahead, sorry. So you're welcome to join us, and you know what? Here's the deal. Here's the deal. If you come play with us, I will play under my alternate gamer tag, which has no ranking.
Will you?
Yes. Okay. You know what that alternate gamer tag is. Okay. We play that and we'll play that. I don't know if that will help or not, but there we go.
It's really worth playing.
Oh, yes.
Have you tried Orisa yet?
Yes. I haven't had the chance. Yeah.
Yeah. I played her quite a bit.
How is she?
She takes a lot getting used to. You know, she's got the between the shield and the buffs and whatnot. I still haven't warmed up to her yet. I just haven't played her enough. And as with anything with Overwatch, it's about team comp. And if you don't have the right team comp, then she just tumbles over. Like any of the characters, they just tumble over.
Right. Because her ultimate is support focused, isn't it?
Yeah. What it does is it throws down like this thing that looks like a drum, and it basically provides a buffing bonus to all the characters in the area. You see this like tendril that comes out and connects, and you're getting buffed and shielded and whatnot.
Okay, cool.
So yeah, little back rub.
Yeah, little back rub. Little breakfast in bed.
Let me work that out for you.
Yeah. Is that the VO from the commercial or the trailer of her?
The one that I did last week?
Yes.
Yes, a couple weeks ago.
Is that the voice actress of the character, or is it just unrelated?
Unrelated.
Okay.
Unrelated. So you should go.
So the creepy girl voice is not part of the
game? She's the actual person that invented it.
I see.
So she's
part of it.
Yeah, she's the inventor. The actual, she may be the voice because it's more robotic. Mm-hmm. Please stand behind the barrier. She's got a very robotic voice. Anyway.
I see. Maybe it's a recording of her.
You could be. Right.
Played back through.
But processed,
robot voice,
as we say in the industry. Go on. So that's what you're playing.
Yeah. and playing the work life and WoW games.
Okay. Well, I don't. From everything that I know about people that play WoW, they can't either have the previous two if you're playing that third one. Right? When you play WoW, you have no work and you have no life. Fair. Would that be accurate?
You're looking at the wrong guy.
So, Jeffrey, what do you?
Yeah.
Wait a minute. That's a fancy shirt you have on.
Yeah.
You like that?
You normally don't wear a collared shirt like that.
Well, thanks for noticing. This is a very backhanded compliment.
No,
right?
No.
It doesn't even have ketchup stains on it. Give me some time. It's funny because this is the first time I've worn this shirt, and thanks for noticing. And I was driving in, and I had coffee in my hand, and I'm like, I'm going to spill coffee on this shirt because it's white.
No, I like it.
All right.
It's very nice. I don't see any coffee stains, so you succeeded.
Yeah, and I'm sure if it was on camera, it would have like a horrible effect on the camera.
Yeah, if you were on camera, we'd have to have the epilepsy warning before.
Yes, no doubt.
Where were you when you first spotted it?
My wife bought it for me. That was
bad. See, that's
here's the thing. If I buy something that I like and I get home and she doesn't like it, it goes in the back of the
closet. Do you have, and Laura, I don't know if this applies to you, but do you have, and Graham and Jeff, do you guys have a particular color you always buy when you go out in the shirt? Like with guys, I know when like we shop by ourselves, Laura, I'm not judging or saying, but
okay.
Like I always go to this one particular color that my wife gets so angry because I always buy the same color and she never lets me wear it. And I don't know if that was the same with you guys.
So you always buy the same color.
Yeah.
You bring home the same color.
Right, of different types of shirts.
Do you have tons of that color in your closet?
Well, they've mysteriously gone, they've disappeared.
Oh, really?
So,
I'm at the point where 90% of my clothes is video game swag. So a lot of black t-shirts, a lot of black Hanes beefy tees.
Yeah.
But left to my own devices, it's going to be teal or purple more often than
really?
Not.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good.
Wow, top to bottom.
Yeah, that's why I loved like the Sunset Overdrive swag. Yeah. Like I hoarded that. Yeah, I got a lot of that. Matching shoes too.
I'm okay with the teal and purple. That's
not together. I wouldn't wear them together.
Okay.
What about
you, Graham?
Marlin
style. I've noticed as I've got older, I'm going more to blacks and grays.
Yeah.
As you can see.
As I can see.
As a standard. I don't know what that says about me. Maybe that I think it makes it slimming or something.
Ah, anyway.
But yeah.
I digress.
What's your color? Is it purple?
The color that I'm not allowed to wear that I always buy.
Yes.
It's this weird rust. It's like this weird mahogany rust, dark red, and my wife hates it.
Ox blood.
Yeah, it's any of that. And so I don't look good in it, but there's this part of me that's colorblind-esque in this area. They all kind of look the same to me. I'm like, oh, that looks good. I don't have anything. I guess it's because I realized I don't have anything like this color. My wife's like, that's because you look terrible in that color. So out it goes. Anyway, I digress. Jeffrey, what do you
think? No, we're good. So, I've been helping my brother move, and he's like sort of been on the countdown to moving out of state. And so I had been letting him monopolize Zelda. And so I needed another. I've been traveling a ton. So mm-hmm. my travel game has been on my Surface. I've been playing Stardew Valley crazy. And it is so good. And I don't understand why a game, I don't understand why it has its hooks in it, me the way it does. Like every day I wake up and I water plants mm-hmm. and then I milk cows.
Yes. What are you growing in your farm?
Oh man, I'm growing amaranth. I don't even know what that is, but somebody asked for it. Hops, and I'm brewing pale ale right now.
Oh my God. You know, if you wanted to, you could move out to like Duval, which is a rural part of Seattle.
I'll tell you what,
farms
right?
Duval.
It's made me think about like, what's my post-apocalyptic plan? I think about mm-hmm. this a lot. And too much. And I feel like if I get a bunch of chickens and some mayonnaise machines, you just need to throw the eggs in there. A couple hours later, you have mayo, and you can sell that for a lot. Mayo's going to be very in demand.
I don't
after the apocalypse. Yeah.
When the bomb drops or whatever happens, really mayonnaise is what's going to be the
economy. No, actually, what I think... maybe
for
DLC. But I think, I've tried to think, like, what would my role be in mm-hmm. post-apocalyptic society? Society, mm-hmm. And I have like a ton of coffee, and I feel like coffee will be like a luxury that whatever mm-hmm. local warlord would love. And I have a lot, all of my coffee stuff is manual, doesn't need any electricity. So as long as I have hot water, I can grind the stuff. And I was like, I could put this all in like a backpack and I could be like a traveling barista that could offer up a taste of the old world in exchange for like a roof over my head and not killing me on sight. So I think that's the niche I'm going to carve out for myself, when when we get into like Mad Max era mm-hmm. But until then, mayo machines in Stardew Valley, it's really working out for me.
Okay, good.
Yeah. So
before you move on though, I must ask, have you played Farming Simulator?
I have never played Farming Simulator.
Okay, this is your next
game. All right.
Talking about training yourself for
post-apocalyptic.
That's that's what my role will be. It'll be a farmer because I played Farming Simulator and I know all about the different things you have to do.
Maybe if you can like grow,
I can grow
the hops, things, then yes. I can brew the pale ale. And
together,
let's just, how about this? Could. Let's have like an agreed upon place. If there's a mushroom cloud someday, like God forbid, of course, but you know, first I'll pick up my kid from school.
I don't know what's going on.
And then
here,
we'll meet. Let's really meet somewhere and let's sort it out.
Yeah. I'm enjoying it, though. It's, yeah. It's good to see this all coming together.
No, I mean, because we have
wait,
to
wait a minute,
stay
wait a minute,
together.
Wait a minute. I'm sorry. I just not to poke holes in your cute little plan here, guy.
Okay.
So you're going to make coffee.
Debbie Downer.
You're going to make coffee.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Laura, you can't really grow coffee in this area. So no. What are you going to be growing?
Corn.
Okay, so we got a little bit disconnect because I don't really want a corn drink.
Hops would work.
Okay, well, we're in Seattle. I'm not going to be growing the coffee. I'm just going to hoard. While everyone else is hoarding Costco or whatever they're going to be doing, I'm going to be going into, we have like 8,000 Starbucks. I'm going to be grabbing all the beans, seal them away, and get enough to last for a long time. You know, and then again, travel around and see what I can.
You're just if you're just trying to figure out what's going on here, and you're looking at your device, going, "I thought this was a gaming podcast."
This is the Preppers podcast,
yes,
right?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. In all seriousness, post-apocalyptic DLC or whatever for Stardew Valley or for Farming Simulator would be. Mm-hmm. There's a game
that
there.
Would be pretty interesting.
That'd
be
really good.
Yeah, the walking. Yeah.
I'm going to pay you money to download content that's going to blow up my farm, and then I have. Okay,
did
sure,
you,
why
did,
not?
Did you ever play SimCity?
Yes.
I mean, come on.
Yes, yeah. Of course.
I like that idea. Yeah. Post-apocalyptic farmer.
All right.
Yeah. I mean, look, that's the way it's going to need to happen, and I hope you find a niche after.
We need to give it some more thought. Yeah. I didn't realize people were planning out so much.
But until then, while...
I know something I don't
know. Well, yeah.
So while electricity's still working, another game I've been playing, my in-laws are in town, which means I haven't been able to. My game room's taken up.
They set up shop.
My God.
They took no time to move
it. I don't know
it.
When they're leaving, by the way, which is not great.
Jeffrey.
Yeah.
The guest room is open in my house for you.
I may have to come by. So I've been playing games on my laptop, and I've been playing a lot of Xbox Play Anywhere titles. And a new one that came out this week is called Snake Pass. Mm. And this game it looks stunning. It looks like a rare game from like maybe 10 years ago. It has a very aesthetic that's similar to Banjo-Kazooie.
Viva Pinata.
Viva Pinata, like very colorful, but like with modern graphics. It looks very nice. And it's very interesting. It's like I would call it a platformer, but you're controlling a snake, which I've never done in any game that I can ever think of. You cannot jump. Mm-hmm. So you are sort of, it's kind of like you're driving, but a lot of the mechanics involve climbing. So it's kind of like playing Quap, but with no limbs, like because you're a snake. It's kind of hard to explain, but it's a very interesting mechanic. I've been having a lot of fun with it.
Puzzle platformer?
And most of it is figuring out how do I get to this place. And there's sort of like a delicate balance of like coiling. Being a snake is hard. Ooh. I didn't know this, but now I have a whole new respect for snakes. And this one's very cute.
Are you playing as a boa? Or are you gonna like wrap around?
You look like a coral snake. You know, like one of those ones that would kill you in one bite. We haven't gotten to that point yet. You don't actually attack, at least not where I'm at in the game. I'm maybe about 20% of the way through. But anyway, for $20, it's one of the best looking ID at Xbox games I've seen. And again, it's Xbox Play Anywhere, so you buy it once for Xbox or for Windows 10. And you can just jump back and forth. Your saves go back and forth.
Hooray!
So Snake Pass, check it out.
You gonna put a link to that? You gonna put the show notes?
I can do that. I already put a link to the Aberdeen controller, Graham.
Did you find it? Did you?
Yeah, of course.
Oh, nice.
I'm playing, just to bring things up, I'm playing Mass Effect. We talk about that. Of course, we mentioned Overwatch, my Overwatch, mad Overwatch skills, which apparently, Laura, you're overinflating them, I must admit. I must admit. Playing that. I am playing Zelda. Mm-hmm. I find Beetle incredibly creepy. I'll just say that.
I saw your tweet.
Don't think of. Oh, I have met Beetle. They've. Merchant.
Beetle's the merchant. We keep running into this particular mobile merchant. It's like, oh, hey, it's you again. I think we were married in a previous life. Yeah, okay, dude. Settle down, okay?
Coming on strong.
Yeah, right? So anyway, I'm having fun with that, of course. I'll give you some of my patented tips off the air if you'd like, Graham.
Fine.
I heard that you were giving them to Shannon. Good friend, Shannon.
That's right.
Well.
Yeah, Shannon and I, who runs our portfolio, she and I had a meeting, and we were waiting for the meeting to start, and she had her Switch, and like, so, you know, I was giving her some, we were finding out where we are in the game and whatnot, and I gave her a few tips. Just nice. Okay. So
from that last podcast,
yeah,
when Jeff was watching you playing it, it didn't sound like I wanted to take any of your tips.
Well, that was
a thousand ways to die.
Wait a minute, Graham. Now you know when you start a video game and it's usually an open world, you're trying to experiment.
Right.
Like, can I do this? Can I do that? What's going on here? And here's what I've learned about this game with Zelda. You've played enough of it. Now you're an hour or two in, a few hours in.
Yeah.
Jeff, you played, Laura, you haven't had a chance to play. Yeah. It's the game that says yes. Can I chop down that tree? Yes, you can. Can I get on that raft? Yes, you can. Can I go to that mountain? Yes, you can. Can I die this way? Yes, you can.
can I fish with dynamite? Literally.
Yes, you can. So it's the game, like I say, that just says yes.
That's
I like that.
That's the way I describe it. Anyway, so that's kind of what I'm playing. Big game. I've also had a chance to play a little bit of Thimbleweed Park, which is now available. It's an Xbox Play Anywhere title. It's available on Xbox One right now. It'll be coming to PC soon. Mm-hmm. But we've got Ron Gilbert, legendary Ron Gilbert. So I had a chance to catch up with him. So you guys want to listen to that?
Absolutely.
Thimbleweed Park is out this week, and joining me on the line is legendary Mr. Ron Gilbert. Ron, good to have you on the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Well, we haven't chatted for a while. Last time I had you on was for The Cave, and it's so good to have you back. I know a lot of people have been excited for Thimbleweed Park. I fired it up on my Xbox One, and some people saw that I was playing it a little bit early. But a lot of excitement around this game. Why don't you jump right in and tell us about it?
Yeah, no, there has been a lot of excitement. I'm really, really happy about that. You know, we did a Kickstarter for it a couple of years ago, and it's a point and click adventure. And, you know, Gary Winnick and I, we both created Maniac Mansion. We were talking a couple of years ago about just the charm that those old Lucasfilm adventure games had. And, you know, while a lot of modern adventure games, you know, I think are really good and I enjoy them, they really seem to lack whatever that charm was that those old games had. So, you know, we did a Kickstarter to kind of build this game to see if we could figure out what that charm really was. And so that was really kind of the, you know, impetus for doing the whole thing.
What? So, I mean, I don't want to spoil, I mean, not, we're not going to give away game spoilers, but tell us about what, if you're able to encapsulate, what is the charm? What did you find out at the end of your journey?
I don't know that I really found out anything, to be honest. You know, we've had a lot of people play the game. We had a lot of play testers come in, and we've had press that have played the game, and everybody says, you know, oh yeah, this is exactly like those LucasArts games. So I feel like we did recapture that charm, but I don't know that I could actually quantify what it is. Yeah. I think some of it is, you know, I've always looked at building adventure games as almost improv game design. Mm-hmm. You know, that you design stuff and you play it, and then you think of weird funny ideas and you put them in the game and you play them and you think of more funny ideas and you put those in the game, and it's just very kind of evolving, you know, improv design. And you know, we certainly have done that with Thimbleweed Park, and I do think that is a little bit of the charm of that stuff.
When you know, it's interesting you talk about that process, because a lot of the, you know, for a lot of the, you know, these the big AAA game developers and designers I talk to, they talk about how there's so much pre-production, and there's a point in the production where you can't really change anything. And so you're saying yours is a little bit more fluid. But when, you know, with all of the iteration, and you're like, oh, this is funny, or let's add this, when do you draw the line and go, okay, we can't add anymore, we got to ship it?
Well, I think you draw that line. You know, we have a process where we go through what we call content lock, right? And we do that for Thimbleweed Park. We did that about 2 months before, so
right.
two months from now. And content lock is really the point that we go, okay, you know what? We're totally done.
Right.
We're only fixing bugs at this point, and we're only fixing like serious bugs at this point, because we really need to get a very stable version of the game, you know, through tests. So content lock is the point where we say, you know what? We're kind of done, and we're not going to add any more content to the game.
You know, I want to talk. You talked about Maniac Mansion, which you were the writer, the art director. You pretty much did everything on that thing. You know,
didn't art direct. Gary did all the art for Maniac Mansion.
Sorry about that. So that was, you know, a few years ago. You know, 30 years ago. What you know, you talked with Thimbleweed Park. You did a Kickstarter. which I, according to what I was able to research, started in about 2014 and you started development on the game in 2015. What was the timeline like for Maniac Mansion versus Thimbleweed Park in terms of, you know, Maniac Mansion probably was the target platforms. There were fewer, maybe the development tools were a little simpler back then. So what are the differences from a technical perspective from back then to now? They must be pretty epic.
Yeah, they're quite a bit different. You know, Maniac Mansion, when we first started working on it, was only for the Commodore 64. So sure. We only had one platform. You know, it was obviously ported afterwards, but during the core development, it was only for that platform. So we only had to worry about one platform. Yeah. But tools, you know, we had no tools. I mean, we had to build all our own tools, right? If we wanted to do graphics for the Commodore 64, we had to build a graphics editor, right? You couldn't just go buy that stuff like you can now.
Right.
You know, we had to write our own assemblers and compilers and all that stuff. So we were, you know, doing a lot of this very core tool development for the Commodore 64 version of the game. And it took about a year and a half to build Maniac Mansion. And, you know, that was the first game that we'd ever built. You know, yeah. So there was a lot of learning, you know, we have no idea what we're doing. Let's just kind of do this. You know, Thimbleweed Park took about 2 years, but Thimbleweed Park is a much, much bigger game than Maniac Mansion was. You know, Maniac Mansion, I think, had 46 different rooms that you could go to. And Thimbleweed Park, there's over 90 different locations that you can go to. And it's a much more complicated game than the Maniac Mansion was. So it's really kind of hard to compare, you know, the development times, that stuff.
Now, it's interesting you say that because the games, you mentioned it, the games at the surface, they feel very similar, but you're saying once you kind of get down below and you peel it back, there's actually a lot of differences and Thimbleweed Park's much more complex.
Yeah, there's a lot of differences, you know, if you look at it, because, you know, if you first look at it, you know, it kind of looks a little bit like Maniac Mansion, right? Yeah. It has the kind of big bobble-headed characters and, you know, the way the rooms are laid out. But the art is actually quite different. You know, we're using a lot of very modern technology. You know, we use shaders and real-time dynamic lighting. So you're walking around these, you know, 8-bit rooms, but, you know, light is being cast on everything dynamically. And the way we've really always thought about the game was, you know, we wanted to build a game the way you remember,
yeah,
you know, Maniac Mansion and Monkey Island being. Not the way they actually were, but the way you remember them being. So we've applied a lot of very modern technology to the game to kind of, you know, be able to simulate your memory of those games.
Yeah, because it's interesting you talk about all the dynamic lighting, and when people look at 8-bit, they really don't think of things like that. But you're able to kind of use some of the modern tools to do things back in the Commodore 64 days that would have required, you know, those old digital sleight of hands, right?
Yeah. I mean, things like lighting. I mean, we never could have done anything like lighting. You know, we're also using really nice, you know, digital music for the game, which, you know, we couldn't have done back then. And it's just the amount of memory that we have, you know, I mean, modern computers, you know, essentially have unlimited memory, right, you know, for the type of art that we're doing. And, you know, building Maniac Mansion and Monkey Island, we were always just completely constrained by the amount of memory we had or the amount of disks that we needed to ship on. And we just don't have those concerns today. So we can do as much animation as we want and as much sound effects as we want and music and all of these things, which really helps quite a bit.
You talked about the music for a second. I was looking, you've got Steve Kirk, who some people may know from another classic, Voodoo Vince.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Steve added the music here. That must have been a lot of fun to work with him.
Yeah. Steve is great. I love Steve a lot. And, you know, I really like working with musicians that, you know, I trust enough to just go make me some music.
Right.
You know, and they can go off and they can do stuff. And I just have complete trust in Steve to do that. You know, it's like we talked about these very general ideas of kind of mood and feel and style. And then he just went off and did this music. And it's wonderful music. I really like the music in the game a lot.
Now, I pointed this out before I did the interview. I called out to Twitter for some questions. You're on Twitter at Grumpy Gamer. I'll put a link in the show notes to your Twitter profile. But Ryan Brown wanted to know, have you played any free indie point and click games, and what do you think of those?
Yeah, I have played some. I actually don't play a whole lot of point and click adventure games. I find that when I play point-and-click adventure games, I spent all my time deconstructing them and not actually enjoying them. So I don't actually play a whole lot of those for entertainment value. The last one I played that I actually enjoyed quite a bit was called the Mermaid of the Milky Way, I believe it's called.
Okay.
I don't want to mess that name up. But that one, that's kind of a small indie 8-bit game that I really kind of enjoyed quite a bit.
Just Brian from Twitter wanted to know, am I going to bang my head against my desk figuring out puzzles like I did 30 years ago in Maniac Mansion?
Well, I hope you do, but in a good way, right? Because, there's puzzles that are kind of frustrating, and then there's puzzles that are just challenging and interesting, right? And the goal as an adventure game designer is to create puzzles that are really challenging, and you spend a lot of time, and, when you complete the puzzle, you're like, oh, I should have thought of that, right? Oh, that was a great puzzle. It's kind of like the player should be kind of in this competition with the game and not this competition with the game designer,
right?
As soon as the player feels like they're battling me, then I feel like I've kind of lost them, right? They should be battling the game and the fiction of the game and the world and the characters and the narrative and all of those things. So I think puzzles can be hard and be challenging, but they shouldn't be frustrating, right? That's the kind of line that we try to keep.
Talking about the Thimbleweed Park, let's talk a little bit about the story and the narrative. Where does it take place in the timeline, and what can folks expect?
Well, the game takes place in 1987, mm-hmm. which was the year we released Maniac Mansion, which was kind of the reason we set the game in 1987. And it's about these two agents that come to town because this body was discovered in the river just outside of town. So they've come to town to investigate who killed this person. But that's really kind of the tip of the iceberg, because you really quickly realize when you're playing the game that it's really not about the body, right? Mm-hmm. That the agents are kind of here for very different reasons, and this town is really kind of this very screwy little town, and actually nobody really cares about this body, right? It sits in the river out by the bridge the entire game, and it's like nobody really cares about it. And that's kind of, what you discover as you're playing it is that body is just like the tip of this kind of iceberg of oddness that is Thimbleweed Park.
Yeah, because I've been playing it a little bit, and it's exactly right. I was like, wait a minute, but what about the body? And you're right. It's just the story just kind of continues on past that. That just is. I don't want to call it a MacGuffin, but it's kind of just this thing to get you started. And you know, and I don't want to spoil anything more about it. But it is a lot of fun, because you talked about it being the spiritual successor to Maniac Mansion and Monkey Island. Does it exist in those universes other than the time? I haven't gotten that far in the game. Are we going to see any crossovers?
Well, there's a lot of, a lot of stuff that we do that, pokes fun at that stuff. And there's, some weird little cameos that happen. Since we made all those games, it's interesting for us to put that stuff in. They don't exist in the same universe per se, but we do a lot of, little homages, to our past work.
Are you surprised at how some of the point and click games and these story based games, like The Walking Dead and so forth, have really continued to go on, and versus these big AAA first person shooters and these massive open world games, that there's something kind of refreshing and simplistic to go back to these types of games?
Yeah, there is, and I think has a lot to do with the narrativeness of it. Obviously people love stories, right? We go to movies, we read books, we watch television. We just love stories. And, the old adventure games did a really good job of telling stories. I think that was one of the things that they did really well. And if you look at what I call modern adventure games, things like maybe Firewatch or, the Walking Dead stuff, right? They really have taken that narrative thing and really focused on it, right? They've kind of lost the puzzle solving part of adventure games, but they've really kept the narrative. And I think a lot of that also has to do with how diverse the audience is today. It was a very small audience, back in the 90s for games. But, thanks to a lot of the mobile platforms and stuff, everybody plays games these days, right? So it's not this weird little niche. And when you have a very diverse audience of people, you can have a very diverse you know, styles of games. And I think that's where, you know, things like The Walking Dead and these more narrative focused games have really started to shine, because they've really brought in a lot of different people into gaming.
You know, you mentioned back in the day, because I played, you know, I played Monkey Island and Maniac Mansion back in the day. And it was very different back in the 80s and early 90s, as you said, not just because of what you just mentioned, because it was smaller, but because we really didn't have the internet to go to and watch a YouTube walkthrough video. We had to go down to our corner computer store or maybe find somebody at school that was into that. Does that impact the way you develop the puzzles? Because obviously I remember hitting my head against the keyboard. I don't know what's going on. I didn't have anybody to talk to.
Yeah, the internet is interesting, right? It's this kind of, you know, always on hint system that you can go to. And I don't think it really impacts how we design puzzles, because I think it's the kind of thing that you can never really defeat, right? You can't design a puzzle that is internet proof, right? unless there's a whole bunch of randomness to it. And I think when you start adding a lot of randomness to puzzles, I think they become just more irritating than anything. So when we're designing the games, we don't really think about that. You know, there are people who are going to enjoy the game as they walk through the game with a browser window open, right? You know, just following the thing, and they'll still enjoy the game, and that's fine. And there are other people that will enjoy the game, you know, by not looking at any hints. YouTube stuff, you know, the walkthroughs and everything, that's, you know, or the let's plays and stuff, that's really interesting for narrative games. And, you know, whether, you know, if somebody can sit down and they can watch like a 4-hour playthrough of, you know, the Walking Dead game or something and go, well, I don't need to play it now because I really saw the whole game. Right? That's kind of an interesting question. You know, Thimbleweed Park is a large game, right? You're not going to be able to get through the game in 4 hours. So, you know, it's not going to be the kind of thing you just watch a quick video. But I think when you're designing games, you know, to kind of, you know, let's play proof them in a way, I think you just need a lot of depth to it. Because what you want is you want somebody to be watching a let's play video and go, oh, I wish he would have done that. Or I wish she would have gone here.
Right.
And then that's the thing that makes them want to buy it. Right. Yeah. If they see all the things that the person doing the video didn't do that they wanted to do, then they'll go purchase it. So I think that's kind of a depth issue that you want in the games.
You talked about, you know, Maniac Mansion and The Secret of Monkey Island and Thimbleweed Park having some callbacks and the similarity, and it's very familiar. What are some of the things you were able to do in Thimbleweed Park in terms of play style or some features? You know, you talked about the lighting and obviously some of those things, but maybe some things that you're able to kind of bring it up to spec with and modernize it. What were some of the things you're able to do in Thimbleweed Park that you weren't able to do in Maniac Mansion or Secret of Monkey Island?
Well, there's some small things. You know, in Maniac Mansion and Monkey Island, you know, we had scrolling, right? So you'd walk left and right and the screen would scroll left and right, but we never had vertical scrolling, right? You could never walk up.
Right.
You could only walk left and right. And I mean, it seems like a stupid small thing, but you know, there's vertical scrolling in Thimbleweed Park, right? And it's like, wow, we can do rooms that are really tall now, and you have to walk up staircases. And you know, that's a silly thing because it's so easy and everybody does it today. But you know, for us, it was kind of an exciting, you know, type of thing to do. I think the other thing is just voice.
Yeah.
You know, there was no voice in Monkey Island or Maniac Mansion, and being able to do fully voiced games where we get actors that, you know, help kind of, you know, bring the characters to life in a way. I think that's really cool. You know, I love audio. I love voice in games.
Yeah, well, it's interesting you say about the horizontal and the vertical, because I remember, you know, playing some of those games back in the day, and I was really into game development back then. And, you know, I wasn't a game developer, just a game player. And I just remember, wow, this is amazing. And you know, back in 87, I remember reading about all the sprites and all the different technology you guys had to use to really do what was, you know, essentially now looks like very simplistic, you know, just scrolling left and right. But that actually was a pretty big feature.
Yeah, it was. I mean, scrolling back in Maniac Mansion, I spent months working on that code, you know, to try to get that thing to just, you know, scroll left and right. And, and you know, like the Sierra Online games, they were our main competitor at the time. They didn't scroll.
Right.
They didn't scroll at all. Right. So we kind of felt that was our big selling point.
Right. You know, that's a big feature.
We scroll, you know, it was a bullet point on the back of the box, you know, scrolling rooms. You know, so that kind of stuff. I think, you know, you're always trying to kind of push the technology. You know, it's like back in Maniac Mansion days, we were pushing the technology by having rooms that scroll. And, you know, now we push the technology by having dynamic lighting and all these other things. So I think you're always just trying to push the technology to make the game just a little more visceral.
So Thimbleweed Park, the back of the box is rooms that scroll left and right and up and down.
Like vertical scrolling.
Vertical scrolling. We have voice acting. Are there any other bullets on the back of the Thimbleweed Park box that we should look at?
Well, we have a swearing clown. I suppose he probably deserves a bullet point.
Well, you know, it's interesting because clowns are one of the big things that I'm scared of. So I don't know if I'm going to. And I saw the clown. Can we talk about the clown's name?
Sure.
I thought it was brilliant.
Yeah.
Go ahead and tell us.
Yeah, Ransom the Clown.
I don't even want to know.
Ransom the Insult Clown, yeah.
That lives on the 13th floor of a hotel. I mean, that's just great stuff right there. Well, again, I don't want to talk too much about the game because I want people to experience it themselves, but it's available now, or it's available on the March 30th on for Linux, Windows, Mac, iOS, and Xbox One and Android, and it's coming to other consoles later this year. Is that accurate?
It's not on the mobile platforms yet.
Okay.
So, we'll have it on the mobile platforms in a couple of months, but it is on the Xbox and Windows and Mac and Linux, yeah.
And the thing to point out is this is actually, it's a Play Anywhere title. So when I buy Xbox One or Windows 10, I get the other platform. How do you feel about, I mean, how do you think about that? That's actually kind of cool.
Yeah, I like that stuff. You know, things like cloud saves, right? Being able to play the game on one computer and pick it up on another computer is really neat, right? Because people are so mobile. You know, they're kind of moving around, they're playing here, they go to friends' house to play, and being able to have all your save games and all that stuff is really nice to have. I really like that.
Yeah, I know I'm going to be excited where I can like start it on my, I've already started it on my console, but then I can go to an office and while I'm waiting for a meeting to open up my Surface and pop open Thimbleweed Park and work through a few things. So I'm really excited about that. So thanks for being a part of that program. So listen, Ron, I'll let you go. I'll make sure I link off to you on Twitter as well, because I know a lot of folks are going to want to hit you up there. So hit up at Grumpy Gamer on Twitter for that. Thimbleweed Park is coming out. It basically, by the time you listen to this, it will be out. So I want to make sure everyone picks it up. And Ron, thanks so much for your time today.
Yeah, thank you. This is great fun.
Thanks to Ron Gilbert for that lovely interview.
He's great.
He is, isn't he?
I mean, we can't really talk that much about the game because I don't want to give away the spoilers, but it was just great to talk about what it was like compiling games back in the day versus now. And anyway, a lot of fun there. Thank you, Ron. His game is available right now, Thimbleweed Park. Check it out.
Absolutely.
Check it out. Jeff, you've got some of the news and headlines over the... Now to the news desk.
Whoa, hey, thanks dun, a lot, Larry. Dun, dun, busy dun, day dun, 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 on the freeways. First of all, have you downloaded this new Xbox One update?
Yeah, that's a big update.
Huge update. If you'll know it if you have it.
How do I know it?
Because
you'll have it.
First of all, your home screen is going to look a little bit different.
Yes.
Right? And things will load much faster.
Speed.
You've been asking for performance. You will receive it in this update. My favorite immediate change is one button to home, or
Agreed.
One button to guide. So back in the day, as in yesterday and every day before
last
that.
Last week.
You had to double tap the guide button, or the Xbox button, you may call it, in order to snap and bring up other things or go back home. Now, if you hit it once, you'll notice it will just jump right out there. You can easily start beam streaming. You can access your pins. You can check out your achievements. And you can form parties. There's a ton you can do. You can even form parties now and do a lot of things with parties through Cortana. So if you're in a party and you want to invite people to a game, you can actually say, Cortana, invite party to game, without pausing the game, without taking your hand off the controller.
Yep.
And you can do that now. There's a ton of features.
There's also a little, if you're a gold member, people forget because they don't follow me on Twitter or whatever, that we remind you to get your games with gold.
Oh, yeah.
And a little note there. Just these are the games you can get this month. So we're always trying to make sure you don't miss out on any cool freebies.
Mm-hmm. So I mentioned Beam integration. You can now get up and streaming like very, very, very quickly.
So fast.
So you'll see like a little satellite dish. Yeah, you hit the Nexus button, the Xbox button, and you will see like a little satellite dish down on the left. You hit that. There's like two or three settings, and you're up and going. And so what's cool is, I think it's the first time we've done this. When you take the update, the first time you reboot, there's an option to watch a little video about all the new features there. And I highly recommend you do watch it because it really walks you through how to do all these new things. There's an amazing variety of things in terms of co-pilot mode, which is enables two people to work on something together. It might be good if you're playing with a small child and you want them to have certain controls over a game. There's screen time limits for kids. There's, for the more technical savvy, there's a Blu-ray player bitstream pass-through.
We have some Atmos stuff coming soon.
Yeah, so there really is a ton of stuff. I'll link out to a post that really details
yes.
everything, but there is an awful lot there. One of my favorite things, actually, you know, we had Ray Cox, Stallion 83 on campus yesterday.
He was in the house, yeah.
And he was doing stuff for Beam and for this new update. And he was, of course, taking advantage of the new achievement tracker. So you can actually essentially pin an achievement so that it stays up on your screen, sort of in the
center.
There's
a translucent window and it tells you how you're doing.
Yeah. And so if you're trying to get to a certain thing and you, instead of jumping back and forth to see how much your progress you're making, it'll just stay up there for selected achievements.
Nice.
So if you're trying to grind something out, that's a good way to do it.
You know what I need is, Laura, I think, and Graham, I think you'll agree with me. Do we need a Stardew Valley stream? I think we do, don't we?
I think we do.
Jeffrey, we need to
I would love to walk you through this.
We need to see...
see your farm.
I'm only going to ask that you do it if you're wearing overalls.
Let's see. What am I wearing? Actually, I'm.
Yep.
I need a backwards hat. I dress like sort of like hipster farmer.
Yeah.
It's going to be very
backwards hat. I hear that's quite
local
the thing.
Locavore.
I think you're a little older for that, though.
Definitely a little too old for that.
Backwards hat thing.
Backwards hat.
So another piece of news. Have you messed with the Elytra in Minecraft, which is the glider?
No.
No.
All right. I highly recommend it. I've talked about it on the show before. You can, when you're playing in creative mode, you can sort of hover and float wherever. But there's actually, if you get these Elytra wings, and I'm probably saying it wrong, you actually can fly in very quickly. And it really is like a tremendous feeling of freedom. And it's saying that in Minecraft is saying something, because it's like as free as a game you could ever have. So one of the things that I was doing, it was popular in my house, is sort of setting up a little obstacle course and try to fly through the rings. Well, now there's a free update that has hit Minecraft, which actually, it's called Glide, and it's a free mini game that lets you test your skills with Elytra. So definitely recommend you trying that out.
Okay.
Big news,
yeah.
Destiny fans. So earlier this week, Destiny 2 was first announced, and there was more of a reveal trailer that came out.
Yes.
That was actually, depending on when you're hearing this, just maybe yesterday. So you get to see some looks, and we have a blog post up on Xbox Wire, and you can also pre-order and pre-download. You can find that on majornelson.com. So if you're interested in Destiny 2, I know I am, this will be your first look at it. And no doubt we'll be learning more pretty soon. It's coming out September 8th, which I feel like was the same day that the first one came out 3 years ago.
Sounds about right.
Yeah.
Seems like just yesterday we were over there.
Wow. Yeah, 2014.
Wow.
In fact, we did a stream.
We did.
From the Bellevue from Microsoft store. That was fun. That was the first time I'd ever done us.
Was I there?
You couldn't make it. Cool. So it was you, me, and Will Tuttle did a stream from the Bellevue store.
Was
it was pretty fun.
I don't know. I think you might have been at another launch event.
Who knows?
We made the front page of Twitch that day.
We did?
Yes.
Oh, no
this
way.
Is when Beam was just a glimmer and that saw some
Indies. Have you ever been in the Scottish Sun, though?
I've never been in the Scottish Sun.
Wow, okay.
The Fort Lauderdale Sun Sentinel. Another Xbox Play Anywhere title. I know we were talking about Snake Pass and Thimbleweed Park. Another one's coming next week called Enter the Gungeon. I can link to that. That's something that I'd heard about on PC for a while. So it looks like it's very fast paced and fun and will be on Xbox One and Windows 10.
Mm-hmm.
And another game that I just wanted to call out, a lot of ID at Xbox games coming out this time of year. I mean, almost every day. A roguelike strategy game called Has-Been Heroes. It has a really cool look, and it almost looks a little, it's sort of like a washed up sort of hero tropes in like an RPG. And just when you look at it, the way things are lined up, it kind of looks a little bit like an old school 16-bit Final Fantasy sort of layout where you're on one side and the enemies are on the other, but obviously very modernized. It's not it's not pixel art. So might be worth taking a look at that.
Lots of stuff going on. Head over to majornelson.com or news.xbox.com and find out what's going on, when, where, how, and why. But what you won't see there, because I didn't post it, was I tweeted it. Sorry, watching the new Game of Thrones trailer.
Are you doing that right now?
As we look at this. I'll flip it over. See, it's right there.
Oh my goodness.
Look at that.
Can we like pause the show and then
should we
watch it and
all right,
talk about it?
All right, we're going to pause the show. We'll come back. Hold on. We put a link to that in the, we just watched it. You ready? Mm-hmm. Winter's coming, et cetera, et cetera.
Winter is there, it
yeah,
seems.
Yeah, it's there.
Man, that gave me chills.
Speaking of that, we need summer here in Seattle.
So have you been
reading about this? Apparently, this is one of the top rainiest seasons in Seattle we've had in like forever.
Which, when you're talking about Seattle, that really means something.
Yeah.
You know?
I read a depressing tweet, which I didn't really want to read, but I saw it and it said that since October 1st, we've had 5% sunny days.
I can
as one out of 20. That's like 5%. Less than two a month.
I can confirm. I can do math. I can confirm that. My wife reminds me every morning when we wake up. I can't deal with this anymore.
Aww.
So
I always thought I was a bit of a lucky charm because whenever I came to Seattle, the weather was usually pretty good. But lately, it's been
yeah.
And last time I was out, yes, snowfall.
Your luck has worn off, my friend.
Yeah, isn't it?
The same thing happened to me. Like when I lived in the Bay Area, every time I come up here, because it was usually for PAX or something in the summer. And I was like, what are they talking about? It's just an urban legend. Yeah. They don't want people moving here. And then I moved here in November and I didn't see the sun for like 3 or 4 months.
Yeah.
And I realized, no, that's not over.
All right. So that's your weather, Game of Thrones and game news for the week.
I've got one other bit of game news that I noticed this morning that
go ahead.
I quite liked is that Far Cry 3 is now
back and pat.
Back and pat.
Yeah, that back and pat list keeps growing.
It does, doesn't it?
And way over 300 titles.
I always loved that. Speaking of farming. The mission in Far Cry 3 where you had to, you know, burn up the farm.
You had to burn up the farm. That's right. I forgot about that.
Specialist farm.
Specialist.
What was the song that they played?
Make It Bundem. It's a Skrillex song.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Remember they matched the song really well.
Yeah, it's like when dubstep was the thing.
Yeah.
But it was quality though. Yeah, it was a great mission.
Jeff and I played a lot of Far Cry 4. Oh, we did the whole game co-op, didn't we?
Yeah. All the missions you could do co-op.
In that gyrocopter.
Yeah, I don't think you could play the main missions co-op, but you could do all the forts or whatever.
Speaking of that, we got to get into Ghost Recon.
Yeah, I don't know how we haven't, but let's make a note of that.
Is that something you play at 6 o'clock in the morning, Graham?
Yeah, we play anything at 6 o'clock in the morning.
That's true.
If I'm up.
That's true.
Although it's usually Minecraft or Lego Worlds.
Right.
It's a new one now, so yeah.
How is that?
We've been enjoying it actually. Yeah, Finn really took to it well. Yeah, so it's, I guess it doesn't have the same, you know, Minecraft, everything like performs exactly as you expect it to do. It's got that amazing sort of structure running through the game. I guess Lego Worlds is a little bit looser than that. So you can be more intricate if you want to, but it's kind of more difficult to create really impactful things straight away, but it's got a lot of depth. And the gameplay itself is more, I guess, is more objective based. You're going around helping people and collecting gold bricks and stuff, but you know, visually and everything, it looks fantastic. We just love Lego as well. So.
Yeah.
We did your game news, your TV news, your weather news,
your post-apocalyptic planning news.
We have one more bit of news. Movie news.
Yeah.
Rogue One, now available digitally.
Oh, is it?
I've already seen it 3 times. I've already watched
it
on my Xbox 3 times.
That's great.
Yeah, I need to do that.
Go watch the bonuses. They're very good. Yeah, they're always good. I mean,
is it good the second and third time around?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
This could be one of the most beautifully shot Star Wars films. It's just really the frame and whatnot.
I'm on the hunt for a 4K TV.
Yeah.
I'm about ready to pull the trigger, and I want that to be my first 4K Blu-ray and play it on Xbox One.
So I have, actually, it should be in the house today. I ordered my 4K Blu-rays for Planet Earth 2.
Ooh.
Oh, nice.
So awesome. I'll let you borrow those.
I didn't know they were out yet.
They just came out like this week.
Did they?
I don't know. They usually come out in the Europe probably before then. Maybe it's worldwide with the DVD.
That's going to look ridiculous,
right? So I'm looking forward to that, popping that ye old Xbox One S and taking a look at it.
I actually met a cameraman from Planet Earth 2 at an event we were doing for Dead Rising 4,
right?
I guess in December,
right?
And he had like what he does is he builds these remote control rigs,
right?
Steady cams on them,
sure.
And he's basically built this modular system where you can fix any different type of camera to it.
It's basically like Legos.
Sort of stuff. Yeah. And it was really cool. And then he remote controls it all. But he was in the one where they had all the locusts.
I haven't seen anything yet.
Oh, it's so good.
Okay.
Anyway, so see, he's actually in the show because they do these really nice like making of bits at the end of each episode.
Well, everyone wants to know, how did you get that shot?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you can see him in there. But he was saying that he had seen it in 4K, you know, as part of the production process, like back in October or November of last year. And he said, it just blows your mind.
So did he go out, like spend like 2 years in the in the outback or out in the wilderness to get that 1 15-second shot?
Yeah.
I mean, there's some amazing stories that come out of this.
Yeah, no, that's what they're saying. It's just like, you know, so much travel and so much time,
right,
just to get those moments,
right.
That must have been amazing to work on that. I mean, what an achievement that is.
Yeah, precisely. Incredible. Anyway, make, put a link off to those as well. All right, so that's what we have. We got name the game, Laura.
Yeah, before we close
We close here, I mean, we're kind of bringing up the rear. We got to get, Graham's got to get on his airplane.
That's right. Can't let Graham be late.
I have a story for you before we go, though.
Do you want to tell it now before we get
It's up to you guys.
Go for it.
Okay, sure. We can't.
I guess it sort of fits in news, but I don't know if you saw this, but we had our first Xbox Design Lab controller proposal.
It was not the first.
Was it not?
No. You know who the first was? The first that I know of took place on Christmas, and it was Stallion 83.
That's was right. It?
Yeah, yeah, I sent him the controller. Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Maybe it was the first in
Europe.
East side. Yes.
On the east side. Yeah. You call it Europe.
Yeah.
On the east side. I like that. Oh, well. Okay, well, that takes the wind out of my sails a little bit, so thank you for that. But congratulations to Stallion 83. And
yeah, they're getting married in June.
Fiance.
Sorry, I really ruined that.
Well, no, not at all. No, we had... We met a guy called Erwin from the Netherlands maybe 2 years ago at Gamescom, 2 or 3 years ago. And he's a massive Xbox fan, and he's stayed in contact with a lot of people at Xbox on Twitter, especially over that time. And he got in touch with Aaron Greenberg and said that he wanted to propose to his girlfriend, and the way he wanted to do it was with an Xbox Design Lab controller.
How about we'll put both of those proposals in the show notes?
We totally should. Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. I'll find those.
What I'm looking for right now, since you dropped that one, is I just got an email. Somebody sent it to major@xbox.com. Laura, I don't know if you saw this. And it was we have the first 1 million gamer score person over in Asia.
Oh, really?
Let's see if I can pull that up here. I'm trying to desperately search.
Well, while you're doing that, I just want to say congratulations to Erwin and to Mandy, his lovely fiancée, because they're going to be getting married. And she got a really cool Xbox Design Lab controller out of it as well. So that's
cool. What color did you
choose? Better than a ring, really, isn't it?
Maybe.
Let's be honest.
Maybe. What color did you choose?
It was sort of pink and a kind of powdery blue.
Mm-hmm. Oh, powdery blue is popular. This was Stallion's.
It's almost like the reverse of that one.
Yeah. It looks a lot like my custom.
She won't use it either. She's just... You know, she sort of has it up on the mantle.
Yeah, get on them. Yeah. That's good.
Really sweet. That's
all right. Really sweet. Thank you for that. Also, I can't seem to find that email. I'll see if I can dig it up while Laura works on her name the game. Laura, you got your name the game?
I am ready now. Let's
all right. You've got the recording. You press that little green play button right in front of you so we can play back last week's name the game. All right.
Let's roll that tape. So that was Name the Game from last week.
Yeah.
Actually, 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
And the game was Trove.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty easy one. Anyway, the winner we have is Carl from Texas, and his gamer tag is Carl on Xbox. Congratulations, Carl.
Do you know him?
No.
You're from Texas.
I am from Texas. So are a lot of other people.
Do you ever get the thing like, oh, my, I have a friend of a friend who works at Microsoft.
I get that all the time. Yeah. Like, you know that friend? I'm like, no.
There's 115,000 people
that
work.
There's a lot of people that work.
My mom and dad have been doing that lately with me. They met someone in the UK who knew someone who worked at Microsoft. And they keep asking me every time, oh, have you looked up that guy yet? And I'm like, chill out. I'm not going to know him. It's fine.
But maybe you do.
No, I don't think I do.
Oh, okay.
He sounds like he's super intelligent. You know, not to say that I don't know lots of super intelligent people at Microsoft.
Hey, we take offense to that remark. On behalf of Laura, I take offense of that remark.
Thanks, Laura. All right, let's tell Carl what he's won. Carl, you've won a bunch of awesome stuff here. You've won a copy of Trove, the Essentials Pack, a copy of Goat Simulator with the new Waste of Space DLC, which is a really fun game. I should get that at DLC. It should be super fun. You also get a copy of Dark Souls 3 and the new Ringed City DLC.
Jeffrey.
I need to get on that.
Jeffrey.
Looking at you, Jeffrey.
I'm so out of practice.
You also get a copy of This Is Police.
Step out of the car. This is the police.
And a copy of Thimbleweed Park, which we talked about earlier.
Talked about earlier today.
Exactly. And that's not all. You also
get
a copy of Mass Effect Andromeda and the 2150 Mass Effect Andromeda points. Oh, no. Sorry, you get 2150 Mass Effects.
Okay, not 2000, not 2200, 2150.
Which is really odd.
Apparently, it's right under the tax limit where we have to tax you if it's more than that. I know I have no idea what that means.
Okay.
Anyway, congratulations. We'll be Carl. Laura will hand deliver your prize because you know Carl, like we discussed.
Of course,
Texas.
Everybody who lives in Texas.
Yes, you do. Anyway, so does that mean you have another one?
I do. Let's do a name the game for this week. So that was Name the Game for this week. If you too would like to win awesome prizes, it's super easy. All you have to do is send me an email and include what game you think those sounds are from. My email is lollipop@xbox.com and ccmajor@xbox.com.
Nice.
Yep.
You can also reach out to us for anything else.
That's true. We like to know, you know, where all of our listeners are from, mm-hmm. or how you're doing. Mm-hmm. Just pop us an email.
If you happen to see that, if you have that issue of the Scottish Sun, is that what it is?
Yeah. Scottish Sun, yeah.
The Scottish Sun.
I think it was the Sunday edition.
Did you just try a Scottish accent there for a second?
Stop it. I know what you're going to
say. You know exactly what we're going to say. Do they have any no-calorie soda up in Scotland?
Yeah.
Yeah? What is it called? What is it called? Just curious.
What?
Is it
diet?
A Coca Light?
What? I don't know the reference.
No, it's called Diet Coke.
Oh, Diet Coke. Okay.
Diet Coke.
Yeah. Okay. Actually, well, in
Iron Brew is more of the
stuff
you're
drinking
in
Scotland, yeah.
No. I've traveled around. I've been fortunate enough to travel all over the world with Larry. And what I've noticed is he's a Diet Coke drinker, especially when you've traveled 9 or 10 hours to Germany, for instance, and you need some caffeine, mm-hmm. and where they call it Coke Light.
Yeah.
But whenever Larry orders it, he just affects a sort of like a comical mustached plumber Italian accent.
Coca Light.
Coca Light.
I can't help it. I don't know why.
Even in Germany.
Everywhere.
Especially in Germany.
It's consistent Italian accent.
Apparently, I've been consistent.
I wouldn't really call it an Italian accent. It's just a.
I don't know what it is.
Yes.
Okay, now that you've thoroughly embarrassed me,
I'll look out for that.
I can't get you to blush very often, but I was worth it.
Thank you for that. Thank you, Laura. Good luck on Name the Game. And if you don't bring me a Coca Light, please. All right. Hey, I found that gamer tag. It's his or her name. I don't know. It doesn't say. His gamer tag is Sangrias, and they are from Seoul, Korea. And they are one of the first people in Asia to hit 1 million gamer score.
Wow, congratulations.
So they got their gamer score. Achievement was you're too easy on, you're a millionaire. Who wants to be a millionaire? So pretty
clever. That's clever. I appreciate that. Mm-hmm.
So anyway, I wanted to say, Sang is your name. I wanted to say congratulations. We got your email and give a little shout out to you.
Yeah, that's quite
all
an achievement.
All our fans in Asia, especially. I've never been to South Korea. Do you have Diet Coke in South Korea?
I want to go. We should go there.
We should go.
I want to go there.
Do you want to go?
I've never been further than Germany in that direction, on the east side.
Oh, okay.
You've come to Tokyo Game Show with us,
haven't you? No.
We need to make this happen.
Wow, that's Jeff and I have stories to tell about that.
Yeah.
Oh, do you?
Independently.
It's amazing. Yeah.
Are they off-air stories?
A
couple of them.
Some of them. Anyway, congratulations, Sang. I want to thank you. You're a big fan of the show. She sent you this email as well at lollipop@xbox.com.
Okay. Great.
So I want to thank you, Sang, for listening and your support of Xbox.
Yes.
What else we got there, Graham? Did you check into your flight yet?
I have checked into my flight, yeah.
Did you pack your bags? You're all set to go?
I'm all set, yeah.
Did you or anybody else come in contact with your bags when you packed them? I'm sorry.
No. He's sending this
getting all
TSA,
for some reason. I don't know what's happening.
No, I'm all set. Just need to drop the hire car and get on the plane. Get the switch fired up again.
Did you charge it up?
I have. That's what I've been doing this
morning. I have a USB-C battery that I used on the airplane.
Mm, that's a good idea.
Yeah, really, because some of my devices are USB-C.
I've got access to a plug on the plane.
I think you do too.
Yeah.
That BA flight, you have a plug.
You face
the old BA, British Airways, eh?
Backwards?
I don't mind it. Yeah.
It's good.
I miss the old days of BA when they used to fly the Concorde.
All right.
I remember that.
Did you do that?
Did you ever get on it?
I never got on the Concorde. I saw it land and take off a couple times from JFK, but never saw it because it would come out over. So you remember the Concorde, of course. It would come out and would go up over. Sometimes it would go up over Connecticut, and we would hear the sonic boom.
Wow.
In the morning when it was coming out of hyperspace. We're going into hyperspace.
Different till I remember it.
Pretty much hyperspace.
Yeah, exactly. So I just remember that, and it was oh god, such a. There's actually one of those in Seattle. Did you know that?
No.
Down at the Museum of Flight, they have one of the So if you ever get to Seattle and you want to go to the Museum of Flight, they have one of the Concordes there. Whatever you want to say it. It's not grape, so it's not Concorde. And they also have one of the old Air Force One. Aircrafts. Oh, there's a lot of really good stuff down there at the Museum of Flight. I reckon. Do you want to hit that on your way out?
Maybe I will. Yeah, do a flying visit.
You have nothing. Time. You have nothing. That's why I unfollowed you on Twitter.
Yeah,
because of the puns.
Oh come on, you never followed me.
Not true. I was for like 15 minutes. And
oh
then,
no.
I
don't.
And then he was out. That's it. I'm not.
So yeah, I don't know. Usually we talk about gadgets and cool electronic stuff. We've have been around. I don't know if we have. Do you have anything, Laura? Nothing you want to talk about?
Nothing I
want to
talk about.
All right.
I would love to hear your then and not just the folks in the room, but anyone who's listening, like any good 4K TV recommendations?
Mm. Yeah.
Kind of looking at the Samsung KS.
Well, it's Samsung or LG are really the two.
Yeah, those seem to be the
two. Is that what you have over in
I went Panasonic.
You have Panasonic?
Yeah. I'll be honest and say that the one I got is pretty entry level.
Right.
But it's kind of like, it's entry level, but it has all the specs that I wanted. You know what I mean? I didn't really compromise on anything, but I don't want to keep the price.
What is it missing?
I love it.
What is it missing?
I don't think the HDR is like, so I only found out afterwards that, you know, there's varying
multiple flavors
of
HDR.
Yeah. So I hadn't really done enough of research there, but it didn't really bother me because I wanted to use it more for, it's our main family TV.
Sure.
Right. So it's doing a lot of different things. So I'm absolutely delighted with it though. Like, I honestly think it's some of the best money I've ever spent on, like, literally anything in my life. Because everything just looks so much better on it. And then when you do stick in a, you know, an Ultra HD Blu-ray on your Xbox One S.
I want to see what Planet Earth looks like.
Oh, yeah.
That's what I'm looking for.
So I watched Revenant on it. Like, I've watched it, like, 3 times.
Really?
And I never watch a film multiple times, but it just looks so
Did you watch The Martian?
No.
Oh, you gotta watch The Martian. Yeah. I had that in 4K is delightful, right, Laura?
All
right.
I have not seen it.
You haven't seen it in 4K?
Not in 4K. I've never actually seen a movie in 4K.
Oh. I'll tell you this. It's tough to, because we're so used to watching things on Netflix and Amazon and Hulu, things are streaming and they say they're 1080p. They're highly compressed. Mm-hmm. And even when you see a Blu-ray disc, it looks so amazing because it's not compressed. Mm-hmm. So it's like, wow, it looks, and then you get to 4K and it's just that much sharper. You know, if you have HDR, the colors pop a little more. It's rather, and I can't even imagine what Planet Earth is going to look like, because those images are stunning anyway. This is just completely, you know, and what's great about Planet Earth is I know it's none of these, you know, these crazy visual effects, and you know, it's not digital. This is the real deal.
Yeah.
This is Planet Earth the way it's meant to be seen.
Absolutely. That's the one. That is going to shift 4K TVs.
You know, if you want, we could probably order it and have it delivered to the gate before you check in. Amazon could probably do that.
I'll wait until I get home.
Yeah, it must be available.
Is Rogue One, is that going to be available on Ultra HD?
Well, I got to tell you something. You know, Rogue One, I got to call my friends at Disney because I'm horribly confused. Disney is known for marketing their films, and you can't swing a dead cat without knowing a movie's coming out, like the Beauty and the Beast. They kind of stealth release this digitally. Mm. And I can't find out when the Blu-ray is coming out. I certainly don't know if it's coming out 4K.
It's next week.
Is it next week?
Yeah, because I saw it. I was in Walmart or whatever, and I saw it in there.
It's like
next Tuesday.
I was looking over on Amazon, and I couldn't find it, and I don't know what's going on. So that's, I got to order that as well. So the answer is I don't.
See that in 4K. Yeah, that'll be nice.
Has Finn seen it yet?
No.
Uh-oh.
That's okay.
Yeah, how old is Finn?
He is 6. Going on 7.
I don't know if this movie is like necessarily.
I gave him the option, and yeah. I was going to see it first. Yeah. I was going to see it first, and then I kind of gave him the. But he's at sort of an age now where he sort of says, I'm not sure I want to see it in the cinema. Let's wait for, you know, Blu-ray or whatever, because he wants to, you know, control the experience a little bit more, which I think is very mature of him. You know, he knows his limitations.
Yeah.
He was the same with Power Rangers. I was like, come on, let's go and see Power Rangers. It looks really good. And he was like, I think it might be a bit scary, so let's wait for DVD.
Who's self-policing?
Yeah, he is.
Interesting.
Yeah, he's a good lad.
I'm sorry. I'm over on Amazon. It's unclear to me. It's completely unclear to me.
It's very strange.
Like I'm gonna put this up on the screen. You guys, well,
usually they're very on top of it.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe I just don't know how to run the web anymore. That's entirely possible. Like there's a theatrical version. So this is by the movie in HD. You know, I click on Rogue One, right?
Mm-hmm.
And where is it?
More purchase options, maybe.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Interneting is hard.
Interneting is hard. Anyway. All right, gang. We'll let you guys go. We will... Graham, I want to thank you again for coming over.
Thank you for the invite, as always. It's a total pleasure.
I can't believe you flew over here.
It genuinely is one of the highlights of my week every time.
Oh, you're so kind.
I flew here just for this.
Yeah.
I'm touched.
No, I was in conferences. So, you know, this is a nice...
Work.
Nice... gear shift, let's say.
Yeah. We're a little more... I'm pretty sure you didn't talk about some of the things we talked about here on... In your conferences?
No, none of this. Although it was good fun.
That's
good. I moderated a panel for the very first time.
Cool.
Good for you.
Which I really enjoyed, actually.
Yeah.
You're very moderate.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'll take that as a compliment.
I have nothing to add to that part of
this. This is the
Laura, just this, all we can do is shut up.
I know.
Just keep our mouths shut, not contribute to the nonsense. All right, guys, you can find Graham on Twitter at
AC Bongos.
You know him, you love him. It's if you want the pun of the day,
yeah,
you go to AC Bongos.
I do my best.
Nothing but highbrow humor there. Find Jeffrey at
Coca-Li. Oh, I'm sorry. Jeff Rubenstein.
That's a Mario. Laura can find Laura at.
You can find me at Laura Lollipop.
And you guys know to find me, Major Nelson. You'll see me on your Xbox every Friday with This Week on Xbox. Where else can they? They can find me on Facebook too, right, Graham?
Yeah, Facebook and
Twitter.
Twitter. Yeah, and you got it on majornelson.com.
Yeah, we do. We got the show is amazing. Everybody gives us great feedback. The secret is we try to keep the show under 10 minutes every week.
All right.
Because we know the average, you know. The average attention span is pretty low.
Check you out with the data.
Well, we just know. You don't want to know how scary the data is in terms of when people tune out. It's 7 seconds, Jeff?
Yeah, that's about how much you get on Facebook. Yeah.
Yeah. So there you go.
Gotta grab them.
All right, gang. Graham, we'll have you on again when you're back over here. Hopefully you'll be over before E3, right?
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll let you know.
Right on.
That'd be nice.
All right. Safe travels, my friend.
Thank you.
Laura and Jeff, we'll see you guys next time. And you, dear listener, thank you for your time. We'll talk to you next time. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Bye.